This screencast will illustrate the use of the Reynolds Transport Theorem through a water park example. So when we're characterizing fluid flow, in the past we've discussed the benefits of using a control volume approach to simplify a problem, and this will be demonstrated in the following example. One of my favorite rides at this water park was a lazy river that had a series of jets in the middle of the river to propel the fluid and thus move the lazy river. Now, if we look at one of these areas and draw it in a schematic, it would look like the following, where we have this block right here shooting water from the base of the river at some higher velocity. So what I'm interested in looking at is the region 20 foot after the jet. So let's say that that's right here. We'll say that's 20 feet from the jet to that point. And we'll say that this channel is 15 feet wide. And we'll say that the jet shooting the water is roughly 5 feet. Right in the middle. We'll also say that the depth of this river is about 5 feet, just kind of throwing numbers out there that seem somewhat reasonable. Now let's say that the water coming out of the jet is at 5 feet per second, and the rest of the water is at 2 feet per second up to this point. And we'll say that 20 feet downriver we have uniform flow, and it's reached a point of 3 feet per second. We'll say that the control volume that we're going to look at coincides with the system of interest at a time equal to zero. We want to know what the system of water looks like 0.5 seconds later, and the volume of water entering and exiting the control volume after 0.5 seconds. So we've defined our problem statement. At this point, I would actually start with a diagram that would be the most useful for solving this problem. So here's the problem statement written out in words so that you can stop at this point and try it yourself. But as I mentioned, the best place to start is with the diagram. And we'll say that from the jet to that downstream location is the control volume of interest, which I've labeled here as yellow. Let's go ahead and put in some relative dimensions that we care about. We know that this width is 5 feet, which means that these two widths are also 5 feet. So we're curious as to find out how this system moves at a time of 0.5 seconds. So for reference, I'm going to choose a couple of points. We're going to say that this is A, this is B, this is C, that's D, and then we have E and F. If we wanted to calculate the distance that that particular part of the system has moved, we could just take the velocity times the time for each of these areas. So let's do this for, say, section AB. Assuming the uniform flow, we have 2 feet per second times 0.5 seconds, so we know that that part of the water has moved 1 foot in that amount of time. So obviously we're going to have to assume that the water doesn't mix, even though we know it would, but we'll draw that this has moved 1 foot. So if we did this for point BC at 5 feet per second, we would have 2.5 feet. So we would draw that a little bit further down. And the other side is symmetrical, so that's going to be 1 foot as well. So if we were interested in that part of the system and what it would look like, we could see that at 0.5 seconds, this system has moved downstream. And we're looking at the region ABCD. Now for EF, because it's uniform on that side, pretty straightforward. We have 3 feet per second. At T equals 0.5 seconds, we have that has traveled 1.5 feet. And we could highlight this region in light blue. So now in terms of answering part A, what does the system look like at 0.5 seconds? Well, in this case, it's going to be the light blue region and the yellow region. The green region indicates what new water has entered the control volume, which was originally what we had depicted with just the yellow. And the light blue indicates what came out of the control volume and started flowing downstream. So if we were looking at the system is what has moved on. The control volume is still just that region of particular interest, the 20 feet downstream. So to answer part B, we need to figure out what amount of water has come into the control volume, which would be indicated in green, and what amount of water has left the control volume, which would be indicated in light blue. So let's start going through those calculations. So at this point, we're going to use the Reynolds Transport Theorem to analyze the mass flow both in and out of this control volume. So we're going to use large B as the mass, which we'll indicate as m. And if we do this, this means that little b is going to be equal to 1, and our equation simplifies to the following. So if we start going through our assumptions that our mass per time is not changing, then the left side of this equation goes to 0. If we assume incompressible and that the density doesn't change, then that left integral looks like the following. We've also removed the density in the right integral, again, because we could divide through. And the last one we're going to make is that our control volume is non-deforming. And so this basically means that we have a steady state for the control volume, and this term drops to zero. So we're left with a pretty straightforward integral that basically says that we want to know the total amount of mass that comes into this, and that must equal the total amount that leaves the. So if we look at what's coming into the control volume, our original control surface was marked right here. And we've broken that up into three regions. Two of them are identical, the bottom and the top. So we'll say that we have two times whatever has broken the control surface. So we'll call this region 1, this region 2, and this region 3. So we're looking at the control surface for 1 and 3. And this is going to be the dot product of the velocity times the normal over the area of interest. And we need to also do this for that second region. So at this point, we could start putting in the given velocities and the areas of cross-sectional flow. But since we're interested in at a very specific time of 0.5 seconds, we could just take the fluid volumes since we've already calculated the length that the water has traveled into our control volume. We know the widths and we also know the depth. So if we want to calculate that entire volume, we'll say volume of section 1 plus volume of section 2 plus volume of section 3 must equal the volume of water that has gone into our control volume. And I plugged in numbers, and if we do this, we calculate that 112.5 feet cubed of water has entered our control volume. If we do this for the other side, what's left, it's a little bit more straightforward, and we'll just skip straight to our volume that we'll say is 5, or in other terms, out. And if we calculate this, we also get 112.5 feet cubed. So in this case, we have shown that the volumetric flow rate in is equaling the volumetric flow rate out. And we've answered the second part of our question by determining what has entered our control volume and what is left. Hopefully, this gives you an idea of both the system approach and a control volume approach for looking at flow.